see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Welcome to the It's in Queens podcast. I'm your host, Jeff Simmons, and this is the only podcast that focuses on my borough of Queens, the most diverse region in our city and, frankly, our country. This podcast comes to you each week thanks to the Queens Economic Development Corporation and the Queens Tourism Council. Together, they showcase Queens as a destination with something for everyone, whether you live here, work here, or you just want to visit. Memorial Day weekend is upon us, if you can believe it. It feels like the first few months of this year really have flown by. And while summer may be on our minds, because really, don't we view Memorial Day weekend really as the start of summer? It doesn't officially start for a few more weeks on June 21st. But that does not stop me, and likely many of you who are listening, from soaking in the warmer weather and enjoying that summer feeling. I think of the Beach Boys, of course. School ends soon. We plan our vacations to get out of town, or we even plan our staycations, which is something I actually enjoy so much more because the city empties out and I get to visit places that are a lot less crowded and I could spend more time there. For me, this time of year is when I also make a point of just stepping outside more and sitting in a nearby park and devoting more time to reading books outdoors. And yes, there's also a lot of people watching involved, and of course, I wind up petting a million dogs. What do you like to do over the summer months? Get away or stay in the city? If you use that time to explore the city for you or your kids, for instance, well, there's little chance you're not going to find anything, something to do. There's always something to do. I mean, there are myriad opportunities to experience culture, to visit our museums and theaters and art galleries, see a show or two or maybe even three. And if you aren't sure where to start, I've got an idea. Now, if you listen to this podcast regularly, you know where I'm going with this. How about exploring Queens and adding a bunch of venues to your must-visit list this summer, starting right after Memorial Day? And Queens makes this very easy to do because June welcomes the second annual Queens Rising. It's a month-long celebration of arts and culture featuring dozens of venues, both big and small. And while I say dozens of venues, many of them have multiple programs for you to enjoy throughout the month. One of them is a venue I've come to know and love over the last decade, Flushing Town Hall. If you're not familiar with it, you likely have seen it. And if you know Queens, of course, and you drive up Northern Boulevard, then you have likely seen the historic building. It really stands out as you're driving along Northern Boulevard in Flushing. It is a hub of cultural opportunities, visual and performing arts. So, for this week in our continuing series featuring participants in Queens Rising, I talked with Dan Bamba, Director of Arts Services at Flushing Town Hall, about the venue and what's on tap for June. Dan Bamba, welcome to the It's in Queens podcast.
Yeah, thanks for having me, Jeff.
Let's get to know you first. Did you grow up in Queens?
So I grew up, I was born on Long Island until first grade. I lived in East Elmhurst. And then when I was in first grade, so about six or seven, I left. We moved out to Long Island where I grew up. And then after college up in Massachusetts and some time in Boston, I've been living in Astoria since 2013 now.
And before you started work at Flushing Town Hall a few years ago, what did you do? Take me, you know, through a little of your career.
Yeah, so in terms of my art career, it started when I moved back to New York. I worked at a gallery up in the Upper East Side. They're now in the Lower East Side. Started as an intern, worked my way up. Being an artist liaison, produced exhibitions, did press, kind of did a little bit of everything. After time at the gallery and some time doing freelance on my own, I started working at Queens Council on the Arts, specifically for their grants programs. After a couple of years, ended up becoming the director of grants and residencies at QCA. So doing a lot of the similar work that I'm doing now at Flushing Town Hall, so which brought me to Flushing Town Hall as their director of arts services, and kind of just a one spot to the next, kind of seeing where I fit in the art world.
And in your current role, what do you do? What's a typical day like for you?
Yeah, so for our art services department at Flushing Town Hall, we have a lot of programs that are really meant to support artists and organizations putting on arts and culture programming in the borough and in the city. So our biggest part is our grant program. So we give grants to local independent artists as well as organizations. This is funded by the New York State Council on the Arts, and we do project-based grants for works and projects and programs happening for the public in Queens. And on top of our grant program, we also do professional development workshops, artist talks for means to meet other artists, to learn different skills, whether it be grant writing, budget making. And then on top of that, I also program and manage our visual arts gallery. And just general support for artists in Queens and New York as a whole. If there's anything that we can do, whether pointing you in the right direction of a potential partnership or just even just another set of eyes for a different grant application, we're just here to make kind of the journey of being a working artist just a little bit easier and ideally get artists to a point where they can support themselves completely just through their art.
You know, I'm very familiar with Flushing Town Hall, but I should not assume that our listeners are. For anyone who's not familiar with Flushing Town Hall, talk about the range of programs that you offer.
At Flushing Town Hall, we are a multidisciplinary art space in Flushing. We also are a CIG, so we're part of the Cultural Institutions Group in New York City. But like you said, Jeff, our programs run the entire range. So as a presenter, we have a 340 person theater. So we do a lot of music, a lot of jazz, a lot of world music. I know I'll probably talk about it down the road, but our biggest concert series is our Global Mashups series. We have a really, really expansive education department with we work with over 40 different teaching artists who are masters in their own fields to work with local schools and students to put on arts education program, as well as our gallery. And we kind of do a little bit of it all. And we are really here, even though Flushing isn't on our name, we're here to serve Queens and the entire city as a whole.
You mentioned global mashups. Those are some of the most popular and well-attended events. Can you just describe a little about what normally takes place at a global mashup event?
It really is kind of the crown jewel of what we do as a presenter. But we essentially, for our global mashup, we do one a month. We just we're bringing it back, which is really exciting after lockdown. But we bring two musical acts, two bands or two performers from very disparate backgrounds, cultural backgrounds, and it's split up into three sets. The first set, the first group will perform. The second group will perform, and then the third set, which is really sets this concert series apart from what people are normally used to, is we put the two bands together on the same stage to just jam together. And often what ends up happening is these groups have met maybe an hour or 2 hours before showtime. So it's completely impromptu. And it's just a way to show this connection through music that there are still this basis connecting us all, even though we're trying to tell the story in a different way, which is really exciting. And then another part of our global mashup, there's a huge dance component. So we'll kind of guide audiences through some dances and then just have the dance floor. And it's especially, I think it's especially important for like a post-lockdown time, but it's a chance to get together again as a community and move, enjoy music, and just have a good time.
Let's jump into the reason you are on this month, Queens Rising. I've been featuring all the participants throughout May, and Flushing Town Hall is going to be among the dozens of participants in June. What is in store at Flushing Town Hall?
Yeah, so we're really excited. We have a really busy June ahead of us, bringing in some new programs, continuations of programs. So the first thing happening on June 2nd is our Cranky Festival. We're calling it Cranky's Take New York. Crankies, if you're not familiar, is a pretty old school traditional mix of puppetry and theater making, where there's a hand scrolled panorama that they crank, and it's basically an old moving picture to tell the story. So we're inviting six different crankies to come perform with musical guests, which is like, I think is one of the first times this is happening in New York, which we're really excited about. And then the following day on June 3rd, we'll be having another one of those global mashups that I mentioned earlier. So this will be Kieran Aluwalia and Yakuba Sissoko. So Kieran performs with the South Asian vocal traditions of India and Pakistan, and then we'll be mashing them with the music storytelling of Yakuba Sissoko from Mali. So that'll be a really, really fun concert with a lot of dancing. So please join us for there. And then later in the month, on June 18th, we'll be having our Juneteenth celebration, where we'll be paying homage to Earth, Wind, and Fire. And then our last really big event that we're really excited is we'll be bringing back the Queen's Jazz Orchestra to perform on Friday, June 23rd, which is their celebration of 15 years as an orchestra. So they'll be playing works by many of the great saxophonists hailing from Queens. So we really love, especially with our jazz programs, to keep it in the New York and Queens family.
And
So, yes.
that's an event that always sells out, if I'm correct.
Yeah, so please, tickets are on sale now. They do go fast. It's definitely one of our hottest tickets. But yeah, these are just kind of four really great performances that we have coming down the pike. But along with that, we'll have our monthly jazz jam. We'll have some artist talks and professional development workshops. So you can see all that on all the other programs happening on our website.
What are you most looking forward to during that month?
Oh man, it's hard to say because it's everything. Because I think we're still at this point where we're so excited to be open at full capacity to bring in people and just especially to work with artists that oftentimes we put on hold for the past couple of years, or we've just had ideas for the past couple of years that they're finally coming to fruition. It's like trying to pick my favorite kid. We love them all, and we really just hope. We're just excited to have our theater open again and just full capacity, get you back moving and enjoying some really great art.
So more broadly, what do you hope our listeners learn or should or know about? What do you hope they know about Queen's Rising and how it celebrates Queens?
Yeah, I mean, I think with Queen's Rising as an initiative that came out of the pandemic, I think it was a really great time for all of us organizations and groups that are working and presenting in Queens that kind of forced us to take a pause and like reconnect as one group, also that we're serving all of Queens. So for me, I think the best part of Queens Rising is just a highlight of like there's incredible art happening in Queens, in our house, in our borough, that you don't necessarily always have to go to other boroughs to see high quality art, high quality performances, that the work that we present is just as valid as any other borough. And I think the biggest thing for me, having worked in the borough for so long, is being able to highlight spaces that are a little bit maybe not on in the front of people's minds, and showing that there's a lot of stuff happening in our borough, especially to mention.
Before I let you go, anything else on the horizon that you want us to know about that's happening at Flushing Town Hall?
Yeah, absolutely. June 15th is our annual gala, so we're really excited about that. One of our honorees is the Broadway star Andre DeShields. So we'll be excited to honor him and all the work he's done. He has performed in our space over the past couple of years. So we're excited to have him back and to celebrate his work. And then throughout the summer, July, we'll be having our visual artist member show, which is always a great way of building community. And we'll have artist talks and an opening tied to that. And every month we have our jazz jam. We'll be having different performances and exhibitions. So definitely check out our website and see what's happening for the rest of the spring, summer. But we're really excited to be able to present to the community.
There's always something happening at Flushing Town Hall. So if people want to learn about all the things that are happening at Flushing Town Hall, where should they go?
So you can visit our website. It's flushingtownhall.org. And all our programs are listed there, our performances, our arts education, as well as our art services.
Dan Bamba, thank you so much for appearing here on the It's in Queens podcast.
Thanks so much for having me, Jeff.
That was Dan Bamba of Flushing Town Hall. Now, you should also go to the Flushing Town Hall website to learn more, and then make a point to visit the Queens Rising website to discover everything else that's coming up. That website is queensrising.nyc. Also, mark your calendars for Saturday, June 3rd, because that is when Queens Rising will bring its programming to the Queens Night Market, and you know how popular that is, featuring an all-Queens artist lineup, including DJ Greg Kaz, the Korean Traditional Music and Dance Center, Alan Gogarty, the Afro-Latineers, and Jenna Fox, as well as speakers from Queens Rising and its sponsors. The Queens Night Market is held at the New York Hall of Science in Flushing Meadows, Corona Park, and the performances will run from 5 in the afternoon to 11:45 at night, with the market closing at midnight. If you're looking for something else to do in June or, you know, the next few months, we always have you covered, because that's where Rob McKay comes in. He's with the Queens Economic Development Corporation and the Queens Tourism Council, and each and every week, he brings us details on some of the more exciting, dynamic, fun, interesting events that are happening across Queens. Here's this week's report.
Well, Jeff, I certainly hope that this announcement makes a bit of a splash. Basically, it is kayaking season in Queens. Well, kayaking and canoeing, too. I don't know if you know about this, but the LIC Community Boathouse operates in Hallett's Cove, right next to Socrates Sculpture Center. So it's about Vernon Boulevard and about 32nd Street in Long Island City. And it has just, it's warm enough, so it started its kayaking and canoeing whenever weather permits. Anybody can go down there. No prior boating experience is required, and the equipment is provided. It's on a first-come, first-served basis, and people go out from there into the East River. It's right near the northern tip of Roosevelt Island. And you're not really that far. If you kept on going to the other side of Roosevelt Island, you'd bump into about 90th Street in Manhattan. But East River is actually, it's not actually a river. It's poorly named. It's a tidal estuary, and it's brackish water. The salt water from the Long Island Sound comes in and meets the fresh water from the Hudson River, and so it's a mixture, and it goes in and out with the tides as per the Long Island Sound. So there are a few different timing problems and issues. There are times when you can't go out. But in general, if you want to kayak in Hallett's Cove, the first day to, well, you could have done it last weekend, but you could do it this Saturday on May 27th, anytime from noon to 5, and then on successive Saturdays after that until it starts getting warm, until it starts getting cold again. And also, I should just mention that there are a lot of Memorial Day parades this weekend. Check out all of them at itsinqueens.com, along with more information on the kayaking. All right, Jeff, thank you, and I hope to see you out there in the water. All right.
Thanks, Rob. That is just a sample of everything that is happening in Queens. Because remember, there's a place you can go to find out everything else that's happening, not just what you hear on this podcast. You can discover this bounty of information, all these wonderful events, at the It's in Queens website. And that website address is itsinqueens.com. By the way, if you are looking for more business-related news, for instance, how to help your business or friends or family members, well, then head right over to the Queens Economic Development Corporation's website at queensny.org. And when you're there, sign up for their newsletter. When you visit any place in Queens throughout the Queens Rising Run, snap some photos, share them with us. Make sure to tag us on Instagram and Twitter. Use the hashtag #ItsInQueens. Because who knows, your photo could become our photo of the week. I'm your host, Jeff Simmons. That's it for this week's It's in Queens podcast, and have a wonderful Memorial Day weekend.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands,